Be our guide, be our teacher, Holy Spirit. Help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And thank you, Jesus. And I have believe I have a word from the Lord, and I really want everybody to stay in the service today, unless you absolutely have to leave. But I want to just pour out what God has poured into me. And I have been praying for several weeks now as to what to share. And one of the things that just kept coming up in my heart was a word that has just been brewing in me now for a while. And it's just this one word, committed, when I was praying about it. And the word committed just kept coming up, committed. And I said, all right, Lord, I said, I'm going to run with that. I believe that God is saying something to our church. He's saying something to us about being fully committed to Him. And what does that mean? What does that look like? Because, and I'm not pointing my fingers at any particular person or individual here or that might be watching or listening. I think there's an issue that's running rampant in the body of Christ, and it's not necessarily endemic to this place or specific here, but I think it's just very broad, that there are a lot of wishy-washy Christians today that are not embracing what it means to be committed. And the passage that the Lord gave me was 1 Kings 8:61, when Solomon was dedicating the temple, when he was dedicating the temple of the Lord. And in his prayer, he was praying over, you know, the instruments and praying for the people and giving God praise. And then when he began to address the people, he said, "And may your hearts be fully committed to the Lord our God, to live by his decrees and obey his commands as at this time." And I was just drawn to the fact that the Lord didn't just say he wants you to be committed, but he wants us to be fully committed. Because we've got Christians that are half committed. One foot in the world, one foot out of the world. One foot in church, one foot out of church. One foot in ministry, one foot out of ministry. One foot in Jesus and one foot out of Jesus. And they're teeter-tottering. And then about 100 years later, after Solomon uttered these precious words, Israel had fallen into Baal worship. And Elijah went to confront the people, confronted Israel. And he spoke to them in 1 Kings 18, verse 21, and he said to them, he said, "How long will you keep hesitating between both sides? If the Lord is God, go after him. But if Baal, then go after him." And the people were quiet. They didn't say a word. The Good News translation, I think, says it beautifully. How much longer will it take you to make up your minds? And really, the word that the Lord gave me came about 50 years after Elijah uttered these words. 50 years later, Joel wrote these words. And he said, "Many, many, or multitudes, multitudes, are in the valley of decision." In the valley of decision. "And there the day of the Lord will soon arrive." And friends, I believe that there are many Christians, many believers, that are in the valley of decision today. And they are struggling. And they haven't made up their minds. And there are many that are struggling. There are marriages that are in the valley of decision. There are ministries in the valley of decision. There are relationships that are in the valley of decision. People are even in the valley of decision whether they want to serve God or not. They're in the valley of decision of whether they want to make this church their home church or not. And like I said, I didn't get this last night. I got this 3 weeks ago. The Lord gave this to me. And I believe that God is saying something to us, that it's time to get off the fence and start getting committed and committed to Him. And before we commit to anything, Because God wants us to commit to something. He wants us to commit to the vision and the plan and purposes of His kingdom and to what He's doing in this house. That's what He wants us to be committed to. He wants us to be committed. He wants us to stop with the teeter-tottering, stop with the sloppy agape, as Ron McManus said, and start making a decision and start making a commitment to start coming to church regularly, start serving in the church, start getting involved in Bible study, not just when you feel like it, but you do it because you're committed. But before we can do any of that, we have to talk about being committed first and foremost to Jesus, friends. Because if we're not first and foremost committed to Him, everything else is just religion. Everything else is just, you know, Amen. You're just doing it because somebody told you to do it. But when Jesus has a hold of your heart, you're going to want to come to church. When Jesus has a hold of your heart, you're going to want to serve. When Jesus has a hold of your heart, you're going to want to fulfill the vision. And we've got to get our priorities in order, like that song says, first things first. I love that line, first things first, I seek your will, not my own, he says. He says, I surrender all my wants to you. And if I could narrow this whole message down to just one word, it would be the word surrender. It's living a surrendered life, learning to live a surrendered life. I'm not telling us anything we don't already know. But before I get into talking a little bit about surrender, let me give you a couple of definitions of this word on commitment. Because the way we commit to Jesus, friends, is through surrender. It's surrendering your life. The word commitment is a feeling of dedication, loyalty to a cause. It's wholehearted dedication. Webster says it's to carry into action deliberately, to obligate or pledge oneself. In fact, the Hebrew word for commitment is to roll. It means to literally to roll something. You're rolling something onto the Lord. It's the idea of completely giving something over to God. It's rolling your heart over onto God. It's rolling. That's what it's a very interesting word. It has this idea of, you know, rolling, like when we talk about like casting your cares, it's this idea of rolling your cares upon the Lord, or rolling your commitment over onto the Lord. It's completely just saying, Lord, I'm all yours, and you just roll right over into God's hands, where He holds you, where He keeps you, where He embraces you, and you stay there. You don't come out from underneath that posture. In fact, the Greek word for commitment literally means to deposit. It's like you're depositing something and you're leaving it there. In fact, if you study ancient Greek, it even goes back to this connotation, this idea of something that is horizontal in its posture rather than something that's vertical. Sounds very deep, doesn't it? Like, huh? What does commitment have to do with something horizontal rather than something vertical? How does that even relate? I mean, it's to place properly in a horizontal position. Maybe the word prostrate gets that idea. It's you saying, Lord, I'm all yours. You're prostrate. You're horizontal. That's commitment. Versus vertical, which is, I'll do it my way. I'm my own boss. I come when I want to come. I do what I want to do. Nobody tells me what to do. I'm going to go my way. That's not the word for commitment, friends. An upright posture assumes a standing position that conveys a lack of submission and humility, that I'll do it my way attitude, versus a horizontal position which conveys humility and submission and full commitment to the Lord. But God doesn't want you just to be committed because somebody like your pastor is telling you, be committed. He wants it to flow out of a place of love for Him. A place of of just what God has done in your heart, a place of love, a place of a fire that burns in your soul because God put it there. It comes from a place of love. But it's got to start with a decision. You have to start somewhere. I was reading about Lou Nichols, a missionary and author who was married for many years, I think over 50 years, and he was talking about how marriage, how when he married his wife, it was sealed by a contract. How when we get married, our marriage is sealed by a contract, it's sealed by a legal document. He said, but as years go by, he said, that contract really just becomes something for a keepsake. He said, because what really happened as the years went by, he says, our love for one another grew. Our love for each other grew. He said, our commitment one to another was bonded by our love. And that contract, that marriage piece of paper, that license was just something for keepsake. But what meant most was our devotion of love to one another. That was real commitment. He said, but you've got to start with a decision. You've got to start with commitment. You've got to start somewhere. You decide that, Lord, I'm going to be committed to you, and I'm going to serve you, and I'm going to honor you, and I'm going to love you. And when you make that decision and you make that commitment, something happens in your soul. God does something. He does something. But friends, it starts. It starts with a decision to totally surrender your life. A total surrender. It's just saying, Lord, you know what? My life is not my own. I'm surrendering to you, Lord. I'm giving you my life, my heart, and I surrender it to you. And I think one of the most powerful, profound verses in the entire Bible that encaptures the essence of surrender is Matthew chapter 16, verses 24 and following. That whoever wants to be my disciple, Jesus said, must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their own life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for me will find it. What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? But those words, that whoever wants to be my disciple, he must deny himself. They must deny themselves. Friends, that starts with a decision. It doesn't start with a feeling. You've got to make a decision. I've got to make a decision every day that I'm going to serve you, Lord, that I'm going to live my life for you, that I'm going to surrender my life to you. It's something that you just do it. To deny yourself and take up your cross in the time when these words were written, everyone knew what that meant. That meant you were going to your death. Because to take up your cross, everyone knew that the Romans made the criminals, those who were headed to their death, they made them carry their cross. That basically meant dead man walking. If you saw somebody walking down the street in Galilee carrying their cross, you knew that they were headed to their death. And Jesus was pointing and saying, do you see that man over there? He's headed to his death. And he says, whoever wants to follow me must deny themselves and take up their cross, like that man who's headed to his death. You don't get to just live the way you want to live and do what you want to do. When you make a commitment to Jesus, it's all or nothing, friends. It's all or nothing. I was reading about a missionary to the Fiji Islands, James Calvert. And he and his crew and the captain of the ship, when they landed at the island and they got there at the Fiji Islands, the captain said, listen, we got to turn around. He says, you are going to die and all your men with you are going to die. He says, if you stay here, you're all dead men. And this missionary, He thought about it for a moment, and he responded and he says, "We died before we came here." That, my friends, is true commitment. Meaning he had already made the decision that, Lord, we're going and we're going all in, and we're going to go to this island to do missions work, and if we die, then so be it. They were ready to die. And I ask you this morning, are you ready to give it all up for Jesus? Are you ready to make a commitment to him? Are you ready to surrender? Because it starts with a decision, friends. And look at what he says here in verse 26, that what good will it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? Now, I know we've done some teaching here on spirit, soul, and body, and you know, we say the spirit is the real you, the soul is your mind, your will, and your intellect, and your body is what you live in. But there are times in the New Testament where soul is substituted for spirit. So just let's be clear about that. So he's really talking about the person's spirit here, you know, the real you. So we just use it almost like a, it's a colloquial, it's just an expression, you know, we're trying to reach souls, you know. We don't really say we're trying to reach spirits. You know, we say we're trying to reach souls for the kingdom of God. You're just representative people. Anyway, just that's just a side note. But I, you know, this word forfeit, the other day when I was studying it, I was looking at this passage. And the way I've always interpreted this passage is that, I believe it is to be interpreted this way. That if you don't give it all up for Jesus and you go after the world, that you're going to forfeit eternity. You're going to forfeit eternity with Jesus. You're going to forfeit heaven. You're going to forfeit it. That's what he's saying. And I know that, and that's true. And I believe that God just spoke to my heart when I was reading this. And he said, son, that's only half of it. You're not just forfeiting heaven, but you're forfeiting my plans and my purposes and all that I have planned for your life. You're forfeiting my presence when you decide that you're not going to live for me. You're forfeiting the joy that I have for you. You're forfeiting my love for you. You're forfeiting everything that I have planned for your life. You forfeit that when you go after other things. And you don't just forfeit your eternity, but you're forfeiting everything that God has for you right here and right now, because you won't make him Lord of your life. You won't surrender everything. You won't deny yourself. You won't take up your cross. You want what the world has, and you want to go after what the world has. You want the fame. You want the glory. You want all of that. And you forfeit what I have for you. And most of all, what you forfeit, and this is what he got over to me very strongly, was you forfeit my presence for in your life. You know, Smith Wigglesworth used to say, I'd rather have the presence of God on me for 5 minutes than to own the whole world with a fence around it. And I feel that same way. Because the presence of God for me, I mean, that's precious. And I spend weekly time with him in his presence, tangible presence. Presence that when you're in his presence, you're in a holy awe. It's being captivated and captured by the King of the universe. In moments, not just life, not just, you know, out here, not just in this moment now, but in that holy of holies, in that place with him. It's that secret place. And to forfeit that? You see, in the old covenant, in the tabernacle, you had the tabernacle is a type of worship. It's a model for your Christian life. When you went into that tabernacle, you had the lampstand on the left, which was a symbol of the Holy Spirit, the light of the Holy Spirit who leads us and guides us. And he it's the only piece of, only article inside the tabernacle that gives light. Without that, there's no light. But that's a symbol of the relationship that you have with the Holy Spirit. And right off to the right is the table of showbread. And that's a symbol of the Word of God, God's provision. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Amen. So it's part of your relationship. And then right up where there's a curtain in the tabernacle, there's the altar of incense. And that had to be, that was burned daily. That symbolizes your prayer life. So you have the Spirit, the Word, and your prayer life. And that was called the inner sanctuary. But then there was something behind that curtain, a 4-inch thick curtain from, at least from Solomon's temple from that era, because there were several temples. But that temple, but behind that altar of incense, behind that curtain, the high priest only went once a year. And that was where the Ark of the Covenant was. And in there was the Shekinah glory of God. There was the presence of God. And now, because Jesus, our great high priest, went into the Holy of Holies, poured out his blood, made reconciliation and redemption available for all of humanity, now God's presence is no longer inside that temple. He's abiding inside you, in your heart, in my heart. And you can have moments with God where he manifests himself, and you get to experience his presence. But if you go after the world, you forfeit that. You lose that. You don't get that. The high priest had to be holy. He had to live a holy life. You know that you've heard of the tradition where they would tie a rope around his ankle and would put bells on it. Because if he went into that behind that curtain, if he did something funny, if he acted in an unholy manner, he would drop the Shekinah glory of God would kill him on the spot. So if they didn't hear the bell ringing continuously, they'd pull him out of there because he was dead. You had to be holy. There was protocol in the kingdom of God. There's protocol. There's a way to worship. Friends, it's not just three songs on a Sunday morning. We're just scratching the surface. I'm talking about you on your face before a holy, almighty God who you feel the presence and the Shekinah glory of God who's gripped your heart and you are captivated by him. And you become a God chaser. God makes you a God chaser, captured by his holy presence, captured. And when we come to service and we come into a place of worship, we're just getting the cream on the top, the icing on the cake. Friends, you and I have no idea what it's like to be in a service where they start worshiping and the presence of God falls and we're doing nothing but lying prostrate before the Lord in his holy presence, weeping, can't even utter a word because you feel the awe, you're awestruck by his holiness, captivated with a God consciousness. And yet, you can have that in your own personal life. Every day if you wanted it, if you'll seek him. If you will seek me with all of your heart, you will find me. And I've been running after his presence for the last 33 years. Because when nobody taught me how to get into his presence, I would feel his presence in worship. I would feel it. And I said, God, there's got to be more. There's got to be more. And I just think God just put it in my heart. I didn't think to do it. He just put it in my heart. I just said, I'm going to go home. I'm going to put some worship music on. I'm going to get on my knees. And I'm just going to wait. And maybe he'll show up. And I did that. I got on my knees. I had the worship going. And when I talk about worship music, I'm not talking about like, you know, we're not, I mean, I'm from that era. You know, I'm talking about something that's just, you know, the chords are like, all right, you know, this is what, if there's something called worship music, this is it. You know, music that you heard today, similar to that. Sometimes just instrumental. And I just, you know, and I put that worship on, and I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden, it's quiet. But it's not just quiet. This is like a level two quiet. This is like another quiet. It's like an awe type of quiet. And I can feel the presence of God. And I feel Him in the room. And what it elicited in me was, I want to get on my face before God, because I'm in the presence of greatness right now. And all that could come out were tears. That's all that could come. I was absent of words, because the presence of God is so powerful and so amazing that words cannot convey what a holy God is really like. And then I just started visiting with God like that almost every day for years. And then there were times when God's presence wouldn't be there. And I'd be freaking out. God, where are you? I don't feel you. Well, you know, sometimes God does that. He pulls away from you. He'll do that. You know why? He wants to see how bad you want Him. The Bible says, surely thou art a God that hideth thyself. Song of Songs says that I searched for Him, but I could not find Him. It's a love song about you and Jesus. Friends, I'm not talking about playing church. I'm talking about a real relationship with the King of Kings. I read my Bible because I want to hear from Him. I want to know Him. I pray because I want to have that connection with Him. I pray because so I can feel Him. And He wants that for all of us. You see, that's completely diametrically opposite of religion. Because religion says you got to come to church because your mama told you to come to church. Religion says you got to read your Bible because your mama said you got to read your Bible. Religion says you got to pray because your mama said you got to pray, and you got to. And now that's good, but don't stay there. It starts with a decision, starts with a commitment, but it needs to evolve into something. It needs to evolve into, God, I got to find you. And if I don't find you, I will die. Amen. It's got to translate to a desperation. A desperation for the holy. That's why Smith Wigglesworth said, you could give me everything. You could give me the whole world with a fence around it, meaning that I own it. He says, but I would rather have God's presence on me for 5 minutes than own all that. Because once you get a taste of His presence, there's no going back. You're addicted. You want to talk about addiction? I'm addicted. I got an addictive personality. See, when they told me to go, you know, they're bringing Honor Bound here, and I want to get a motorcycle now. I've been through a couple of them already. I'm embarrassed to say how many I've been through. Because it's got to be just right. It's going to be the right one. It's never the right one. Once you learn that revelation, you'll be content. But when I give myself to something, I'm all in. All in. I have to be. I don't know any other way to live. I don't know any other way, Patrick. I mean, I'm all in. You know, when I got saved, and I don't say this boastfully, I mean, we had a singles group that we used to go to, a youth group. And thank God, it was called ARC. There's a good name for it. It was Army of the Righteous Kingdom. It was just a group. We had little business cards. It was just like about 10 of us. But that's all I had. I had that, and I had my church. And I didn't have the discipleship that we have available to today. Meaning, you know, where someone comes alongside you. All I had was my pastor and that group. And those two things are what really carried me through. And my pastor used to say, every time those doors are open, get in here. Get inside this church. I never went to one day of counseling in my life, and I had problems. But I used to take all of my problems to the promised solver. Amen. And I don't say that cliche-ish. If you've got problems and you need counseling, you go. I'm not telling you not to do that. But I will tell you this. I got more of my problems solved by sitting at the feet of Jesus than in any other way. Yes. I'm just being honest with you. And just pouring my heart out to him. Just telling him everything. That's the best way to pray. Best way to pray is pour your heart out. Talk to him. And he'll talk to you. You may not hear anything right then and there, but he'll get over to you. He'll help you. Build your relationship. Build your walk with the Lord. And you know what I started doing? I just went to the Christian bookstore and I started looking for books to read. And I started getting a hold of this author, that author. I didn't know what I know now. I mean, I started, and my first book was by Kenneth Hagin. Man in Three Dimensions, Spirit, Soul, and Body. Still preaching that today. And then another book on the mind, renewing the mind. And then on prayer. And then on faith. And I just started reading. It was like a little seed. You know, the Bible says that the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. It's like a little seed that is, when planted, it grows up and becomes a great tree that all the birds of the air can perch themselves in those branches. But I just started. I just started reading. And then I would go on to this author, and that author, and this author, and this author, and then that author. And then I was, well, maybe I want to go to school now. And it just be, the kingdom of God, the Bible says, is within you. And then it just began to grow like that, Lenny. Just began to grow. And you can't see it. You can't see it. You don't know that it's happening, but it began to grow. You know, some people think that when I became a pastor here, that I went out and bought all those books and put them in the office. You know, as props and display to show, yes, I am a pastor here and see how smart I am with all these books. No. That's just years of accumulation. But it all started with one book, this one. Amen. And then another one was added. Because I was hungry. Because I'm all in. And friends, if you're going to serve God, you got to be all in. You got to be all in. You can't be half-hearted. You got to be all in. I don't even know why I don't even know if I'm preaching on my message anymore. And the Lord gave me three things. He said, these are the three things that I want you to surrender. He goes, I want you to surrender your will. I want you to surrender your flesh. And I want you to surrender your time. So now my message can begin. That was the introduction. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. I'm just joking. I'm just kidding. It's almost time to go, my goodness. But I'll just go through these just real quick. I don't have any other slides after this. But these three areas, your will, your flesh, and your time. And my goodness, I have so much I could share here. But James 4:13, because friends, you have, when we talk about your will, and you know, it's just like that song that says this, he says, I surrender. He says, it's not my will. He goes, I surrender everything to you, Lord. You know, first things first. But James chapter 4, I don't think there's a more beautiful passage that talks about the will of God that is so clear than this one here, where James says in verse 13, come now you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such city, spend a year there, buy and sell and make a profit, where you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But no, he says, but now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. You know, if you have your own mind made up about your life, where you're going, what you're going to do, who you're going to marry, where I'm going to work, meaning you have self-created all of that, you could be severely missing it. When was the last time you brought all that before the Lord and said, Lord, who do you want me to marry? Where do you want me to work? What do you want me to do with my life? Friends, when it comes to major decisions in your life, make sure you bring them to the altar and bring them before the Lord and bathe them in prayer and wait on God until he begins to speak to you. Don't just make rash decisions. James is saying your life is like a vapor. It's like you're here one moment and then you're gone. And that's how this life is. It's so short. I posted something on Facebook recently, a picture of my brother and I when we were like 5, 6 years old. He was a little older than me. And I put it on Facebook, and I was standing in front of a motorcycle. Somebody said that was prophetic. It was a picture. And my brother was in front of Bruce Lee, the picture. And I remember we were fighting over who was going to be in front of Bruce Lee. I don't know why I remember like that far back. I must have been like 5 years old or 6 or 7. I don't even know. And I remember when my grandmother snapped that photo, the sun was so, it was just blaring in my eye. I was like this, if you look at the picture. It was like I could barely see. And that image is as real to me today as it was then. And I'm thinking, wow, 50 years, like a vapor. You're here, Zach, one moment, and then you're pushing up daisies. You're dead. Life goes by so fast. Friends, hear me and hear me clearly. Find out what God has called you to do. Discover his will for your life. I don't care how old you are. Well, I'm too old and I'm retired. No. You need to find out if you're where God wants you to be, and you need to find out where he wants to take you. I'm here at this church and my family because God wants us to be here. I'm not here to advance my career. I could probably apply. I could do it. I don't know if I'll be successful at it, because if God's not in it, it's not going to work. You're just going to, I know a pastor, he left his church, Pastor Ken, and he thought he was getting a great church in Florida. Woo, man. I was a little jealous. I was like, man, he's going down to Florida? He's like, I love that weather. I love the tropical weather. I think I'm more in love with the idea than I am actually with, because once I get down there and I get into that jungle, I'm like, oh, what is that? And I'm getting inside. You know, I can't handle the bugs and all this, and my wife makes fun of me. So, but this pastor, he went down there, left his church. He's thinking, I'm going to have the best church, the best time. Man, he got down there, they made his life hell. Miserable. When he got down there, the board would not let him do all the things that they told him you could do when you get here. They wouldn't let it. And he had to pack back up and come back home. And I said, if he had taken my class on how to hear from God. No. That's why you got to find out. You got to spend time bathing these things in prayer. Your will, our will. I mean, friends, a lot of things I want. But that doesn't mean that I can have everything. But learn, surrender your will. You got to surrender it. Your flesh, I don't have much time. This is huge. I mean, you know, I was just watching this popular preacher, two of them actually. I won't mention names. Celebrity preacher, Cynthia. Total celebrities. And popular, I mean, they could out-preach me. I mean, I'm like, man, how gifted. But can't control their flesh. Messing around with women. There's three things in ministry that'll get you killed. You gotta watch, don't go after the gold. Don't go after the girls. And don't go after the glory. The gold, the girls, and the glory will get you killed. Or get you forfeited, get you out of ministry. It's basically money, women, and wealth. Those are the three pitfalls of ministries. And I'm watching these guys. Powerful. I'm talking about 20, 30, 40, 50,000 people at a time preaching to them. And yet, today, it's like their one ministry is on the verge of imploding. And now he's attacking his attackers, calling them idiots. I mean, just totally like, just not. And it's just like you could just see this thing unraveling before your eyes. He's just unraveling. Because they can't get a hold of their flesh. By no means am I perfect, nor are you. But Jesus would never tell us to do something we couldn't do. He would never tell us to deny ourselves and take up our cross if we couldn't do it or if we didn't have the grace to do it. And it's a daily decision. You know, it reminds me of the old story of the chicken and the pig, where there was a farmer's breakfast and the chicken said to the pig, you know, we ought to make a contribution. We ought to go out and give them some ham and eggs. And the chicken said, I'll give him some eggs. Neil. Pig said, I'll give him. He said, you give him the ham. And the pig just looked at the chicken and said, wait a minute. He said, for you as a chicken, that's just a contribution. He said, for me, it's a total sacrifice. So. And then the last thing I'm going to just is our time, and we're out of time. Friends, be intentional with your time. Make it a point to come to church. You know, when we went through this Acts 2 journey with Ron McManus, you know, and I want to have a commitment card made up for our Vision Sunday, which we're going to do in March 26th. And you know, he said something I thought was really powerful. He said, you know, that the people, the church, that we need to commit. This is what he said on the commitment card. You need to commit to coming to church once a week, commit to getting involved in a group, and commit to serving in some capacity. Just those three things. I thought that was really powerful. And I wonder what that will look like here. If everybody came to church regularly, got involved in a group of some type, we're going to be, you know, Reverend Cynthia is going to have discipleship class. We got prayer on Tuesday nights. We're doing a couples meeting. We're going to have to, you know, and there's going to be other groups that are going to be formed. If everybody got involved in just some capacity of ushering or greeting or, you know, whether it be working in the cafe or volunteering in the children's or youth ministry, coming to early morning prayer or coming, you know, to the discipleship class, or just, you know, if we all just got involved in some capacity, what would our church look like? What would it look like if you gave of your time? You know, when we come to church, it should be for the purpose of being fed, hearing from God, and also letting God use you. That should be, that's it. You know, like I said, when I got saved, I didn't come to church. You can start on that. When I got saved, I didn't come to church because somebody forced me to. I wanted to come because I wanted to hear what was God saying. What was He saying? And I didn't want to miss that. I wanted to be fed, and I wanted to know what God had for my life. Like I said, God's will for your life, it has to be discovered. I didn't have counselors. But I knew that if I could get into the house of God, I could hear, God could say one word that would change my life forever. And He will. He'll talk to you. He might just tell you one thing. There's at least one thing that you heard this morning that I believe that God is speaking to you about. It could be just one thing. I have no power in myself. I don't trust in myself to preach a good message. I preach what God puts in my heart, and then I trust the Holy Spirit to marry it to your heart. He's the doer of the work. My Father doeth the works. Stand to your feet. Friends, I just want to ask you this morning, are you ready to make a full commitment to Jesus in 2023? Are you ready for a total surrender to His kingdom, to His vision, to His purpose, to His plans? Are you ready to put first things first? I don't know why I keep talking about that. You know, counseling is good, but you know where your best counseling is going to come? It's going to come when you are in the house of God. That's going to be some of your best counseling. What counselor did Paul go to? What counselor did Peter go to? What counselor did David go to? What counselor did Moses go to and Joshua? What counselor did the early churches, where did they go? You know where they got their counsel? When they went into their fellowship cafe to hang out with each other and their friends, their group. I'll tell you what God told one of the prophets. Jeremiah needed to hear from God. And God said to Jeremiah, go down to the potter's house. Go down to the house of God. And He says, and there I will speak to you. And it doesn't have to come in this, thou shalt do this. You know, it doesn't, that's not God's. He doesn't do that. He might, but that's not His norm. Your pastor, a friend, somebody might say one thing, and it just gets in you, and you hear that. But friends, you gotta apply yourself. You gotta discipline yourself. We gotta stop this sloppy agape, meaning just I'm just gonna do what I want to do when I want to do it and how I want to do it. And no, it's make Him a priority. That's all I'm saying. Make Jesus your number one priority. And whatever that looks like for you, do it. You know, I'm not a very religious person. But there's one thing that really bothers me about our community. It really bothers me, and I don't talk about it, because I don't even know what this is going to look like for my kids. But why do they have to schedule all the sports on Sunday? Amen. I'm sorry. Yeah. Amen. Why can't it be another day of the week? Amen. And then our kids grow up churchless because they're too busy playing sports on Sunday. Amen. I'm not faulting the parents, because a lot of times they don't even, it's like you're caught in between a rock and a hard place, because that's the only time that they do it. So I'm not pointing my finger at anybody, because I'm wondering, what is that going to look like for us? But my point is that the community, it no longer has a fear of God. It no longer reverences God. Where is the reverence for God? Why is it, why, you know, forgive me for saying this. I'm not pointing my finger at anybody here, but I just got to say this. Why is it that if you don't have to work on Sunday, why do you work on Sunday? when you could be in the house of God. Maybe it's because you're not getting anything out of it. That's okay. Be honest with yourself. I can live with that. But if God is really number one in your life, why don't you put Him as number one? And why isn't He number one in your finances? If you say you love God, prove it. That's what God said in the old covenant. If you love me, He said, bring that offering. He says, you prove the sincerity of your love through that gift. There's actually a verse. I don't have it in front of me. What I'm trying to say, I don't care about your money. I don't care if you give or not. I'm not saying that. Please hear me. What I'm saying is, I'm talking about being all in for Jesus, where you love Him. You say, Lord, I'm going to serve you. I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to put you first place in my finances. I'm coming to church. I'm going to get involved. I'm going to be committed. And then you stick with it. And you watch what God does in your life. Watch how He will begin to work in the affairs of your life. The affairs. All the affairs. Friends, I am so grateful. I know churches that have folded up during COVID, struggling. We don't have that many people here, but God has met all of our needs according to His riches and glory by Christ. All for 9 years straight, He's met all of our needs here. 9 years. Actually, today is our 9th year anniversary that we've been in this church. Glory to God. Amen. And we've never lacked a bill to pay. We've never lacked anything. But we have grown little by little by little by little by little. But that's because of the Abrahamic blessing. The Abrahamic blessing. Do you know really where the Abrahamic blessing came from? God put it first on Adam. God said, be blessed and multiply. It was on Adam. And then God put it on Abraham. And then God put it on David, or Moses, Abraham, or Abraham, the Moses, and then David. And then it was on Jesus. And the Bible says that we are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. But when Paul talks about the Abrahamic blessing, he doesn't say and seeds, meaning of many, he says and of one, meaning Christ. Amen. And then that trickles down to you and I. We have Abraham's blessing because of Jesus. It's on Jesus. It's on His church. It's on us. And the Abrahamic blessing is one of increase and multiplication. Those were the very first words that God uttered over Adam. Be blessed and multiply. Those were His first words, to be blessed. Oh, you sound like them prosperity preachers now. Where are you going with that? Friends, everything God touches gets blessed. When God touches on your life, He blesses it. He blesses it, and it blesses, and it trickles out into every area of your life, all the way down, from the top down. And it doesn't happen on your timetable or my timetable. It happens on His. He does it. But you have to get in order with Him. You can't be foolish. You have to follow wisdom. You have to follow, His guidelines. I'm preaching a whole different message now. I don't even know how I got off on that. I'm sorry. That's a topic for a totally different time. All I'm trying to say is, friends, if you'll submit your life to God, He will bless it. He will bless it. Let's pray. Father, we just thank You, Lord. We give You glory. We give You honor. We give You thanks. Lord, we just pray today, Lord, that this message, Lord, that God, it's not the message. It's what's imparted into our souls. God, let what has been imparted today, let it replicate. Let it reproduce. Bring to our remembrance, Lord, all that You have said here today, God. Lord, we love You. We worship You. We honor You. Eduardo, you got to sing that song. I want us to sing that song, Consumed by Fire, First Things First. And Maybe you can sing that for us. I mean, we're pretty much done, folks. But let's just sing that.
I don't want to love what the world loves. I don't want to chase what the world does. I only want you. I only want you. First things first, I seek your will, not my own. Surrender all my wants to you. Keep the first thing first, to live your truth, walk your ways, set my eyes, Lord, I fix my face on you. All my desires reverse, to keep the first thing first. Riches and fame and all that they could buy, I've come to find they never satisfy. What would I gain if my soul's the prize? I don't want to love what the world loves. I don't want to chase what the world does. I only want you. I only want you. First things first, I seek your will, not my own. Surrender all my wants to you. Keep the first things first, to live your truth, walk your ways, set my eyes, Lord, I fix my face on you. All my desires reversed, to keep the first things first. Keep the first things first.
You don't have to go if you don't want to. I just pray that the Lord will bless you in this year, that he will make his face shine upon you, that he will be gracious to you, that he will lift up his countenance upon you and give you his shalom and peace, prosperity, wholeness, success, healing, that you will find his way, that you will discover his will for your life, and that you will fulfill it with all your heart, so that one day when you stand before him, you'll hear him say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." Amen. You are dismissed. Let's sing that again, and you are dismissed.
I don't want to love what the world loves. I don't want to chase what the world does. I only want what the world has. I only want you. I only want you. First things first, I seek your will, not my own. Surrender all my wants to you. To seek the first thing first, to live your truth, walk your ways, set my eyes, my face on you. My desires reversed, to keep the first things first, to keep the first things first. My desires reversed, keep the first things first. make the first thing first, all my desires reverse.